So this is how the lab looks. This is one of the PLCs. This controls the reverse osmosis. This is the water treatment test bed. So, and this runs Allen Bradley PLCs, and something that I figured out was that these PLCs also support Lua. And then the agenda for the day is to introduce Lua. Secondly, is to introduce the Nmap Scripting Engine. And finally, to get the ball rolling for future meetups. So these are the contents. I'll talk about the beginning of Lua, why they even made it, and then some popular use cases, like where you can apply what you learned today. And then I'll be introducing Lua for a while. The whole time I'll be comparing it with Python, something which I frequently use. And then I'll be talking about the Nmap Scripting Engine, and then I'll be showing sample script. So Lua was invented in released in 1993. It was released by three Brazilian guys from PUC Rio, and they made this because till 1994, Brazil had trade restrictions, so they couldn't import technology. They needed a data entry language for the biggest petroleum company in Brazil, which was Petrobras, so they came up with Lua. The first version of Lua had types, but now it does not have any types. So these are some popular use cases of Lua. So the Nmap Scripting Engine uses Lua. If you want to extend Wireshark, you can use Lua for it. If you are interested in AI or deep learning, Torch 7 uses Lua. Recently I figured that there is a library called FluidNet by Google, which also uses Lua. A lot of games run on Lua, for example, Angry Birds, Crysis, World of Warcraft. And then a lot of systems, like embedded systems like televisions and PLCs, printers, routers, they also use Lua. And surprisingly, Adobe Photoshop has 1.3 million lines of Lua. Also, if you watch any movies on the system, so you must have used VLC, you can write plugins in Lua there as well.
What is,
basic, you can always ask questions.
Very basic question. What is, like, can you explain what is Lua? What?
I'll get to that.
Okay.
Yeah. Sorry. Yeah, so these are the games that use Lua, like a lot of games. I borrowed this slide from Roberto. So what is Lua? So Lua is a scripting language like Python, but it's much lighter. So Lua is like Python, but it is faster than Python. It's faster than, so Lua JIT is faster than PyPy, and Lua JIT is even faster than Java. Lua is tiny, so compressed, Lua is at 297 kilobytes, and original Lua is at 1 megabytes, and like it's just 24,000 lines of code. Lua is very powerful, and it is very simple to extend, so it has a very nice C API. So if you have a program written in C, you can extend it to Lua. And then finally, Lua is free, it's under the MIT license. So this is how Hello World looks like on Lua. This is not Python 3. So as you can see, comments start with two hyphens, and there are no braces or semicolons or anything, so it's a very clean language. And if you want multi-line comments, you wrap the comments in square brackets. So yeah, if there are any questions, just ask. So this is a much better example. This example basically calculates factorial in Lua. So Lua doesn't care about white space. I've just indented the code. And then how do you find out if a code block is ended? Lua does not have parentheses, it uses the end keyword. And then similarly for loops, you have the then keyword there. And so io.read is a simple function to read from the standard input. io.write by default writes to standard output. And you concatenate things by using two periods there. So any questions on this?
So what's the difference between io.write and print?
Io.write can be extended to write to standard error or other things like print by default writes to.
Okay.
Yeah. So any other questions about this? I'll move on.
The dot is for combining strings?
Yeah, it's so I'll talk about it. So to concatenate two strings, you always use dot dot, and to do arithmetic addition, you'll be using plus. I have an example for it. So Lua is dynamic, so you don't have to specify the types anywhere. Lua is strongly typed, so if you have to explicitly coerce variables to different types, you can't, the language won't take care of it. And it's duck, so type checking happens on runtime. Finally, Lua does not have any list, tuples, dictionaries. It only has one data structure, which is a table. It's a pretty interesting data structure. Surprisingly, it starts from one. It's not zero indexed. Like every other language is zero indexed. So the creators, they thought that if there's a new programmer, he might be used to starting from one, because we all are programmers here, so we are used to zero, but if there's someone new, they count from one grade. So we have one grade, and if you want to make lists, lists are essentially tables without any keys. So if you don't put keys, they get indexed from one by default. If you put in keys, you can access them by the key. And Lua has no concept of object orientation, so it has fake object orientation which comes from tables, and every module is written as a table. And like Python, Lua strings can be in single quotes or in double quotes, but if you want to write like multiple lines, you use square brackets. Then in Python, empty list or empty dictionaries or zero, such values are false, but in Lua only nil and false are false. And there are some funny things in Lua. For example, if a variable is undeclared, it's nil, so you won't have any naming errors unless you try to index that particular variable. Also, in Lua, variables are global by default, so you need to use the local keyword before declaring a variable to make it local to a particular scope. And plus and dot dot mean two different things. Plus is only for arithmetic addition, while dot dot is only for concatenation. And there's only one numeric type, which is the double precision floating point. Let's move on. So, something that I discovered recently was that tables can be used as keys for the other tables. And so Lua has some syntactic sugar. So in Python, if you make a dictionary which has a key name, you access it like this. While in Lua, you can use the dot notation and still access the name key there. And Lua numbers, unlike Python, are at the same level as C, so the numbers are quite small. So for example, on Python, if you calculate the factorial of 900, you'll get the actual answer. While on Lua, you'll get a very small number, which is basically infinite. And Lua has 8 data types by default. Nil, boolean, number, string, function, and thread are understandable. User data is basically user allocated memory, which you can later use for arrays or other data structures that you define on your own. I have no user data earlier. And there is no string slicing in Lua, you have to use string on sub. Yeah.
So, when you say there's only one numeric type, which is double,
yeah.
How do you avoid full point errors when you do your computation?
Okay, so there are a lot of rounding errors in Lua. So, if even if you store something like a 0 or a 1, it gets stored as 1.000.
Right, so the error just gets get careful at all.
Yeah, so examples are there, but so it depends. If, for example, you're counting from 0 to 1, it will only count to 0.9 if you use the range function. But if you're counting from 9 to 10, it counts till 10. So there's some rounding there. And so this is a simple example. So the first one is a list. So I've not put any keys there. So it gets 1, 2, and 3, and 4 by default. The second one is a simple dictionary. You don't have to put the keys in quotes. It's like this. And these are simple strings in Lua. This is in double quotes, this is in single quotes, and this is in square brackets. It's multi-line. Yep. Then this example basically illustrates the difference between plus and double dots. So if it's plus, it's always an addition. So 1 plus 1 is 2. String 1 plus string 1 is 2. It's not 11. Yep. This is like some quirks of Lua. So if you concatenate two numbers, it's concatenated, and if you add two numbers, it's always added, despite whatever form they are in. And so this is basically a simple sub function for string slicing. So the name is Bill Burr. If you go from 1 to 4, you get all the 4 letters.
So what happens if you do 1 plus 1 plus 8?
If you do 1 plus?
1 plus 8.
It's an error because A cannot be added.
Oh, it's an error.
Yeah, it's an error. Okay, any questions? Any more questions?
Even if the ones are strings.
Yeah, there will be an error. It will say you cannot add non number 10.
I have a question.
Yeah.
If the 1 plus 1 input, is it a string or is it a number?
The output is a number.
Number.
Yeah, 2 is a number.
Even if you're compared
second one,
yes,
is it the output is a number or a string?
The second one is a string because
it's a
it's two it's dots will always return a string.
The third one is a number.
The third one is a number. And so should I move on? So this slide basically shows the different conditional loops and code blocks. So it has a simple while loop. The expression while it's false, while it's true, it keeps on running and it does whatever is in the block. So again, you have two instead of a parentheses, and you have end instead of the other parentheses. And the second is repeat until this expression becomes true. So while the expression is false, it keeps on happening, and when it becomes true, the loop stops. The expression?
No.
Okay. The third one is similar to a Python range function. So in Python, you would write 1, 10, and 1, so it would increment by 1 from 1 to 10. In Lua, you would write 1, 10, and 1 again. And you can have a decimal here as well, so, and you can have negative increments as well, so it would basically go down. And for example, in Python, if you have a dictionary and you are on Python 2, you use dot items. In Lua, you have pairs. So if there's a table and you use pairs, it basically gets you the key and value pair, and you can iterate over the dictionary. But if you're using a list and you want to go sequentially, you use items. So if you have a list of numbers and you want to go sequentially in the list, or if you have a list of characters and if you want to go sequentially, you should use items instead. So again, this is a simple if-else block. So I've already shown an if statement earlier. This is syntactically incorrect because you still need the circular brackets. Anyhow, so you don't have elif, you have else if instead, and else is simply an else, and every other statement has a then keyword there. Questions?
And the items in the dictionary sorted?
No, there's no order in the dictionary.
Then how do you iterate? If it's a list, right?
If it's a list, then you get keys.
The keys 1, 2.
Yeah, you get those by default.
And when you use I pairs, they come out as?
They come in an order.
So it sorts by key first before it runs I pairs?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
I think you missed the bracket in parentheses in the print statement.
Yeah, I mentioned that. That's a syntactic mistake. There should be a practice there. Okay, so this is a simple module. How do you write a module? Everything is a table again. So everything is a table. The score is initially zero. I have a better example towards the future, in the future of the slides. So I'll show that. So this basically shows that everything is a table and everything gets returned as a table towards the end of the file. So I have a better example which shows some object orientation later in the slides. Anyhow, so the operators, you don't have bang and equal to, you have tilde and equal to for not equal to. And you can't do plus equal to in Lua, you have to write a is equal to a plus 1 instead. And as mentioned earlier, something that you should remember is that two periods is concatenation and plus is addition. Then like Python, you can do short circuiting, so true and 1 and whatever. So not and or work as the same as they do in Python. And there's another operator, hash, so if you put a hash before any variable, you get the length of the variable. So if it's a string, you get the length of the string. If it's a table, you get the length of the table. Moving on. So this is how you do imports in Lua. So the first example is basically something like import HTTP as HTTP, while the next example is basically import HTTP. So you use a require statement instead of import. And yeah. So other things about Lua, Lua has no regular expressions in the standard library, but it does have something called Lua patterns. Lua patterns are weaker than regular expressions. They're very similar to regular expressions, but you do not have groups in Lua patterns. You can't match by groups, and there are some other weaknesses as well. But to circumvent that, there are some extended libraries. So if you use LPEG or PCRE or the library mentioned there, you can have regular expressions. Lua also does not have continue, but you have break, and for some reasons the creator decided to introduce go to in Lua 5.2, and now you can use go to have the effect of a continue statement. And Lua is passed by value, but if it's a table, the reference to the table gets passed as value. So if you make changes inside a function, the changes outside also get reflected. And in Lua, functions are truly anonymous, so it's better for functional programming because you have truly anonymous functions. And yeah, so if you go on this URL, you will see a nice explanation of why Lua does not have continuous JPEG. So like Python, you can have multiple returns and multiple assignments. In Python, if you use star list, the data structure gets expanded while it gets passed. In Lua, you can do that using unpack. And so if anyone has done JavaScript before, so in Lua, you can also describe functions like you do in JavaScript. So add is equal to function a comma b, return a plus b, end. So this is basically a one-line function, and the add function would, from now on, add numbers. And I'll explain the fourth point later in the example. Then parameter passing is positional. So in Python, if you want to name a parameter, you can do that. In Lua, you can't do that. So how do you do that? So instead of having the names in the function, you have a table passed, and you can reference points in the table to get the particular values. So instead of having different options as arguments, you have an options table, and you can use options.a, options.b in your function. And for a varying number of arguments, Lua uses three dots as the main argument in the function. And something I recently discovered about Python is that you have for else loops. So if the loop gets broken in between the else part executes, you don't have anything like that in Lua. So moving on. So this example basically shows how multiple arguments work. So three dots basically means that there are a number of, like, there are various number of arguments. So it's a print function that you want to just concatenate everything and print it together. You use three dots. And how do you access the arguments? You use you access the variable argument. So it basically sequentially goes through argument, and it concatenates everything to print result, and it finally prints the print result. So it uses IPS. You have to go sequentially. Moving on. So this example basically shows you how you write a simple object in Lua. Again, everything is a table. So account is a table. This is a constructor. So if the user does not pass a table himself, Lua creates a table by short-circuiting. So if this is nil, this gets created. And then Lua has meta tables and meta functions which allow a lot of things. So though Lua is a tiny language, you can have meta tables and meta methods that can really extend Lua. So for example, if you want to make addition of two tables possible, you would add a meta method to the meta table. So adding two data structures or comparing two data structures or subtracting two data structures, this can be achieved by using meta tables. And so basically, self.index is equal to self means whenever I look up the self object, it will only go through self. It will not go through anything else. And then it returns O. This is the constructor. So this basically shows what I wanted to talk about. So using colon is basically syntactic shows for writing dot and passing self. So if you use colon, self gets passed implicitly. But if you use dot, you have to explicitly mention self. So this function is basically the withdraw function of the count object. And if you pass the amount, it gets deducted from your parents. And towards the end, it returns account because the object has to be returned. So this basically shows you how to create a new object, a new instead of an object. So you use the constructor, you pass the balance, and you can call the withdraw method by either using the colon, which is looks better compared to the full stop, but they do the same thing. Moving on. So this example basically shows how Lua is passed by value. So in the first instance, the table contains three numbers, 1, 2, and 3, but the function changes the first index, it changes 1 to 10. So if you address 10, it becomes, if you address 1, it becomes 10. So it's still passed by value because the reference to the table gets passed as value. It's similar to Python there. And then if it's a string, it will not, if the value of the string gets passed, so you still get hello, the variable does not change. And if you do that with the function also, it does not change because instead of printing 5, it prints, still prints 10. Moving on. So this basically shows is a simple example of function programming in Lua. So infix takes an operator. So if you input plus, it returns an adder. So if it's plus, it returns an adder. But the function has no name there. while in Python you have to define the name of the function and just use lambdas. So in the second case, if you enter a minus, you get a subtractor, and if you enter something very random, it does not, it returns the function that does nothing. So this is a simple example of function programming in Lua. And then here's an iterator. So this here is a closure. So if you create the instance of an iterator, these values still get remembered. So every time you go through to the next value of the iterator, it just increments one and it returns the ith value from the table. So this allows you to write the popular for in syntax. So this is the iterator, and here it just goes through the iterator. For x in the iterator, and it prints x for your x's. So in this case, the numbers get printed. Okay, so talk is happening very fast. Any questions? No questions, okay. So I'll talk about the Nmap scripting engine now, which is a Lua use case. So Nmap is a popular tool used by security professionals across the globe. It allows you to run code scans. So since 2006, Nmap has the Nmap scripting engine, which basically automates a variety of networking tasks. When they were designing the Nmap scripting engine, they had four things in mind: vulnerability detection, backdoor detection, network discovery, and exploitation. And it achieves all of it. Currently, we have around 110 libraries and more than 500 scripts written in Lua. And so it still runs at the same efficiency as you expect from Nmap. So if there's a student here from March, Google Summer of Code, you can apply to Google Summer of Code, and you can get mentored by people at Nmap, and you can get a stipend of $6,600. So it's a really nice opportunity if you're a student. Now, these are some common libraries that ship with Nmap. So the HTTP library basically allows you to make requests like get, put, delete, or whatever. Standard NC library basically allows you to, it basically contains utilities. So if you want to do debugging, you can use standard NC. If you want to find if a table contains a particular value, you use standard NC. To find all the keys of a particular table, the function would be in standard NC. So similar functions are all in standard NC. And then SlackSML is basically an XML parser. It's not DOM based, it's stacks. So as you go through the document, it evaluates, it does not have a memory overhead. And then JSON.Lua is like bytes and JSON library. Then Lua does not have a string buffer in the standard package, so strbuf is a string buffer. And Nmap scripts, they run on things called port rules. So there are port rules, host rules, p rules, and post rules. So when Nmap is running and it finds a host, if the port, so for example, if the port rule is something set to something like HTTP, the script engine will only call the script when there's an HTTP service running on the behind the port. While a host rule would match the host and it would not care about the host at all. Pre-rule scripts are run before a host is scanned, and post-rule scripts are always run. So there are four kinds of scripts and they follow four different rules. And yeah, so I'll just show you HTTP.Lua. At Nmap, we believe in documentation, so there's a lot of documentation here that I'll skip. Like every program, the program starts with some imports, and then it sets the environment. And this basically tests if it has OpenSSL. If the system has OpenSSL, it will use OpenSSL, or else it will not. Or else key call will result into an error. Then there are some functions which are local, so these functions cannot be addressed. You cannot do http.tcopy because it's a local function. While and everything is very well documented. And so this function is also local. I'll get to a function which is not local. So this function basically allows you to perform a simple get request. So the arguments are the host, the port, the path, and options. And again, at Nmap, we use Lua doc. So this style of commenting is essentially gets converted into documentation, and every time you push a script to the repository, the documentation gets updated. So I wish we have internet. So this documentation gets generated from the script itself using Lua doc. Every function which is documented will have some kind of documentation here. So this is a simple if statement that it uses, and then this is, I think I've talked about almost all of the syntax here. I'll demo script eventually. HTTP method is a simple script that finds out the methods that a particular web server supports. So again, the script starts with some imports, and we have the MEC syntax here. So we have some imports, and then you have a description of the script. So this description basically tells what the script does. And then you have some documentation. Again, this is Lua doc, so you can see it online. And every script has an author, multiple authors, and then Nmap uses the GPL v3 license. And then scripts are categories, so this is a default in CS script because it's not inclusive, it's not doing anything wrong. You're just pinging a web server. And then this is the local function. So if you've used C, then you must have seen that every C program has a main function. So the main function for MSC is basically the it's basically the action function. So whenever the Nmap scripting engine finds that a port is running an HTTP web service, it calls the action function and the action gets performed. So I have a simple example here. So I'm running IP webcam on this phone. So I'm running IP webcam on this phone, and I know a couple of things about the webcam. So first of all, it's an IP webcam, so it has IP webcam in one of its headers, and it's running on port 8080. So I'll be specifying, I'll be telling Nmap to only check port 8080, and then it's serving video on slash video, so that path should not be 404. So I'll just write a simple script that does that. Okay, don't think it exists. So every script has a description. So I think all scripts have categories as well. So the category would be safe because I'm not doing anything inclusive, then it could be a default script, and as it performs discovery, I should put discovery as well. So we forgot the imports because we need the HTTP library to make web requests. Short code library allows you to create port rules in a short manner, so you don't have to write functions because the functions for default services are already written. Every script needs a port rule, so then we need the action, which is basically a function post import that passes as arguments. And then we know a few things about the server, right? We know that it's serving at slash video, the video serving is serving in slash video, so that is something that you use. So http.get, I just showed you how it's structured. So host, port, and slash video. I'm not passing options, so it gets an empty table by default. And we have some conditions on the response. So if response or status exists, and if the status is not equal to tilde instead of shebang, then you have, if it's not equal to, then this is of our interest. And then what we do is the header should also exist. Then we just look for IP webcam in every header. So how do we do that? So key comma value in pairs. String.match is a standard Lua function which basically matches strings. You can enter Lua patterns here as well. And so what do we want to match? Header with IP web. So, any questions about the script? I think it's pretty self-explanatory, so I'll just run the script now. So, it's running on the same network as us, so only 69 appears. So, I'm specifying that it should only scan port 8080 and these ports should be open, and the address space is 192.168.100. And -d basically allows you to debug the script. So this script is not release ready because you don't have documentation, you don't have the author's name. So if you want to make a script release ready, it should ideally look like this. This is everything. This has documentation, and the description is pretty accurate, and you need to have the license. So I think the description can be done. It did discover a device with port 8080 open, and yeah, the webcam was coming here. Found a webcam here, so let's try to access the webcam. Oh, here's a password. Oh, okay, so Nmap has a script to find password. So how do we do that? So we look at the script. There is a script called HTTP group, which essentially processes passwords. And at Nmap, we try to have the data set relevant to the industry. So, when has anyone tried this website called Have I Been Pwned? Yeah, so that website basically shows you if you have been pwned or not. So, anyway, there's a data breach like this. Researchers, they perform analysis of what passwords are very common, what usernames are very common. And at Nmap, we have a list of such passwords, so I'll show you the list first. Yeah. So this is a list. This is a lot of passwords here. It's a very long list. It just goes on and on. If you are interested in a list like this, there are...
I hope my password is not good.
Okay, one second now. Enough. Yeah, so this Daniel Meisner, he's a security researcher and he keeps a lot of passwords. So you have 10 million passwords, you have 10,000 most common passwords, and you have a lot of passwords for different things. So if you can basically extend Nmap this to, so this is very few passwords. Okay, so this is the top 100. But there are 10 million passwords as well. These are 10,000 most common passwords. Yeah, so these are the passwords. In, so I just get back to the script. So we'll be using HTTP brute. So I tried the example earlier. Yeah, so Again, I specify the name of the script, which is HTTP brute, and this script is not safe. It's intrusive, as it says. It's intrusive as a brute force script. And yeah, so I run it on this particular host because I know the host address now, and then the arguments passed to it are first only. So as soon as I get the first password, I'm done. So it's running HTTP brute against port 8080. Because when the person wrote this script, he had shortcode.http. He did not have shortcode.http here. I had to extend the number of ports because earlier it was just this, so it would not work on 8080. So you can, because the scripts, they are not compiled or anything, you can actually see the raw scripts. So you can edit them to your suitcase. So it started 8080 here. And yeah, so it found the password. It's web and orange. Let's get back to it. So we can work this. Sorry. So yeah, that was the answer. Any questions so far? Okay, so moving on. So some interesting topic that we see in the next out is object-oriented programming. Yeah. I put the password here, so I knew the password. It was one of the passwords from the 10,000 pages. Yeah. So, yeah, that was Nmap. Some things that you could read about is object-oriented programming with Lua, because I did not really cover that. The main thing about Lua is meta tables and meta methods. They might look scary initially, but if you were writing a Python class, you must have used __str__, so that if you print the particular object, you get it as a string instead of the random things that Python sends. So to do that, you use the meta method called toString. So whenever you print a particular object, you get a pretty output and not something very disgusting. So other things like comparing different objects, for example, if something is greater than the other object, you implement such things using meta methods and meta tables. And Lua patterns, they are like regular expressions, but they're much weaker. I think you can quickly pick up some Lua patterns, like very quickly, like 20 minutes, you'll have enough Lua patterns there to just start reading patterns. Nmap uses Lua's C API to actually control Lua. I have never done that, so I've not talked about it. Then, Lua has coroutines, which are safer threads. Again, I've not used them, but I've seen them in the code base book. So that's pretty interesting. I had one slide on iterators and closures, but that requires some reading. And here are some pretty standard table, Lua library with table, IO, Spring, and OS. And the names are very self-explanatory. So support, Python has 700,000 questions on Stack Overflow. Lua just has 12,000 questions, so a lot of our work depends on Stack Overflow, right? So whenever you run into an error, you try to find it on Stack Overflow. But Lua, you can't do that. For Lua, you have to go on IRC, you have to connect to Freenode, and on Freenode, you have to visit the channel #Lua. A lot of people on #Lua always read it well. And then if you're interested in developing with Nmap, you can join #Nmap on Freenode, or drop a mail to dev@nmap.org. And if you want a link to this presentation, it's at tinyurl.com/teachlua. And Lifo is an amazing Lua developer. So in Python, you have Django. In Lua, you have something created by Lifo. So he creates things in Lua which allow you to do a lot with Lua. He creates a lot of packages in Lua. JC Johnson does a lot of work with Torch 7. So if you're interested in AI, you could follow him. And if you want to talk to me, I'm at anomaly.the@gmail.com. So that's basically from the anomaly from the matrix. That's me. And my website is at gyan.net. And so thank you. And questions?
Yep. You mentioned that for undeclared variables, they are considered as minimal. Undeclared variables
are considered as minimal, yes.
And wouldn't this be troublesome?
Yes, it's very, very troublesome. So for that, Nmap has something called strict. So whenever you write a code, it initially checks if the variables exist or not. So to get by these errors, we have something in place, but yet Lua is a very lenient language. You can make a lot of mistakes and it still run. So, for example, it prints an image. But if you try, if you think that H is a table and it has a name there, it will result in an error. So it's a very lenient language, and yeah, there are some problems that raise. I don't know why they decided to go with go-to statements, because no one uses go-to statements, but they have such things in Lua, but Lua works.
So that means, so when you said about having the string is equivalent to the deposit in Perl, because I'm not familiar with Perl, but you can have certain strict warning if you have, in case you declare un, is declare variable.
How's the packages management like, what's the alternative for PyPy in Lua? It's called Lua Rocks.
And the
scikit-learn? I haven't done a lot of AI with Lua. You've taught 7, it's still not scientific programming, so I don't know the alternative to scikit-learn. But some popular, so get
Lua machine learning stuff still?
Do I?
Machine learning stuff.
There's a lot of machine learning, there's a lot of artificial intelligence in Lua. So you can see the trending repositories here. For example, Torch 7 by Facebook, it's pure Lua. A lot of neural networks are written in Lua. So this, I don't know how this happened, but yeah, people at the AI community picked up Lua somehow.
Probably has something to do with video.
Which
ID?
My GitHub ID? I use Sublime Text, it's enough for me.
Does it work in Jupyter Notebook? Do you have a kernel
for Lua? I don't know. There's a Lua ID though. I have never used a Lua ID, so it like seems to have a plugin for Lua. I don't know if it's supported by Jupyter. I usually use Sublime Text or WebMix, usually.
Is there any, like a GUI interface with Lua?
An ID?
A GUI, a front-end interface.
To make front-end?
Yeah,
it probably has Lua GTK. A GUI interface. There are GTK bindings for Lua. And then probably there are Qt bindings for Lua as well. Is not what I'm shooting for. Yeah, so Torch has a Qt, so you can make GUIs for Lua. So when I was saying that games are written in Lua, it's not that entire games are written in Lua, but the hard part, the thing that needs to run quickly is written in C, and Lua basically connects the hard parts. But if you're interested in game programming, there is Lua Dev, in which you can write games. Yeah, so you can write games, indie games in Lua Dev, so that's the game. Yeah. I think it's better than that. Any other questions?
It's better than
Pi game.
Oh, Pi game.
It's very popular. People need a lot of memory.
Which demonstrates installing third-party packages in Lua from the Lua Rocks that you mentioned earlier.
I don't have Lua Rocks.
Because
I'm usually developing for Nmap, so I just put the library in the NC
library. So you download and then copy-paste into the folder?
No, if when you clone Nmap, all the libraries are usually there. So
they don't have the, but Lua itself has the concept
of
the
package manager. Let's just look at an example. New packages can make so it is similar. Any other questions?
So for what purpose do you use Lua?
I use Lua to write scripts with the Nmap Scripting Engine, so This script, for example, this script essentially, it's written by me. What it does is it finds vulnerabilities in Elasticsearch. So I write scripts for the Nmap Scripting Engine. There are some other scripts as well. So this script essentially enumerates authors of from NSVN library. So I write scripts for the Nmap Scripting Engine. That's my main and I think the only user for that I do. I was looking at this earlier, so I think National Instruments has PLCs which can run Lua, but I have never done that. I can first suggest you in documentation. Any other questions? Is that done?
Thank you, Ken.
Thank you.
Yeah, I guess we would.